Good evening, everyone. My name is Paul Sawyer. I'm the president of the District 1 Community Council, and I really want to thank you for coming out tonight. I think no matter what your political affiliation is, we can all agree that there are a lot of problems that we need to tackle on the east side, and we need to have a robust discussion about how to solve those problems, and I think this is an excellent opportunity to start that conversation. I'm really happy that the League of Women Voters reached out to us, and that we could co-sponsor this event. The League does some amazing work, and I really want to thank SIG and the others in our district who have been doing this work for a very long time. And finally, I just want to say, no matter what your political affiliation, how you feel about any of the candidates, please, please go out and vote on November 8th. Every single one of you, raise your hand right now if you're going to vote. There we go. Thank you.
Hello, and I just want to repeat, welcome everyone to the Minnesota District 67, 67A, and 67B Candidate Forum. My name is Mary Voigt. I'm one of the co-presidents of the League of Women Voters of St. Paul and a constituent, but unfortunately I'm running off to the event at Penumbra for their voting rights event. But I'm glad to be able to welcome everyone here tonight, and thank you most of all to each of the candidates for running and being willing to serve in the Minnesota State Legislature on our behalf. I also want to acknowledge Sig Johnson and Amy Perna for all the organizing work that they did to bring this together. And our moderator tonight, our trained moderator, is a League of Women Voter member, Sarah Risser, who moderated the Ward 2 City Council Forum last fall. She is not a constituent of District 67, and she will present the ground rules and the format for tonight's candidate forum. Welcome.
Good evening. I would like to welcome the candidates and everyone in the audience to tonight's District 67 Legislative Candidate Forum. My name is Sarah Risser, and I will be the moderator tonight, as you know. So I am a member of the League of Women Voters, St. Paul. And along with the League of Women Voters, our event tonight is being sponsored by the District 1 Community Council and Merrick Community Services. The League of Women Voters is a nonpartisan, volunteer political organization that encourages informed and active participation of all citizens in government and influences policy through education and advocacy. The League of Women Voters and the partners who made this event possible tonight do not endorse or oppose any political party or candidate. The purpose of this meeting is to hear each candidate's views on a variety of topics. Any views expressed by any of the candidates tonight are theirs alone and do not necessarily reflect the views of the sponsoring organizations. All candidates running for office in District 67 were invited to participate in the forum tonight. Two candidates were not able to attend due to prior engagements, Chrysia Wydell and Lisa Thompson. State legislators must be qualified voters of the state, be 21 years of age, and must have resided 1 year in the state. In addition, legislators must have lived 6 months immediately preceding the election in the district from which they are elected. Upon election, legislators must take an oath to support the Constitution of the United States, the Constitution of Minnesota, and to discharge faithfully the duties of the office to the best of the members' judgment and ability. These duties include the consideration and passage of laws that affect all of us. Among other things, laws passed by the legislature provide for education, provide our individual freedoms, regulate commerce, provide for the welfare of those in need, establish and maintain our system of highways, and attempt to create a system of taxation that is fair and equitable. I'm going to briefly go through the ground rules. No campaign signs or literature will be permitted in the room. Signs or literature may be placed outside the hall. They may be brought in after the meeting is over. The order of speaking tonight has been determined by a random drawing. After the first round, questions will be answered in a rotation format, and each candidate will be given equal time to respond. Each candidate will have 1 minute to respond to questions. They will have 2 minutes for an opening statement and a closing statement at the end. Candidates will respond to written questions from the audience. Question cards will be collected from the audience, and there are cards on your chair. If you need more, I think you can make a signal and they will be provided to you. No questions of a personal nature will be permitted. A timekeeper will time both opening statements and responses to the question. The timekeeper is sitting in the front row. She will give the candidates two prompts. The first prompt will be given when there are 30 seconds left. The second and last is when the candidate must stop speaking. The sponsors and I myself as moderator reserve the right to ask seriously disruptive audience members to leave. So at this time, please turn off all cell phones. Hold applause until the end of the forum. Two more points. Question cards used in this forum will become the property of the League of Women Voters and the forum sponsors. With that, we will move to our opening statements. And we are going to start off with Sheldon Johnson. Sheldon?
Oh, thank you very much. And hello, everyone. Thanks to District Council Merrick and League of Women Voters for putting this on. Again, my name is Sheldon Johnson. I'm the current state representative for the south half of the Senate District, which is 67B. The reason I'm running is I think we need to invest in kids, local communities, the state, and in particular the east side of St. Paul to make it a great place to live. The issues that I'll focus on are bread and butter pocketbook issues that affect regular working people. So the issues that I'd be interested in then is tuition freezing to make sure that kids can afford to go to college and people that are being retrained, affordable child care so folks can continue to work outside the home and have their kids taken care of, paid earned sick leave for employees so people can stay home if they're ill and they've earned sick leave, or stay home to take care of their kids, or stay home to take care of their aged parents if that is the case. I think that's an important thing. As well as progressive tax policy, which is to say those who make more money should pay for money, and that any kind of tax cuts or tax relief should go to the middle class. I think we need to push hard for a bonding bill when session starts in the coming January. So I'll be very interested in a bonding bill that invests in infrastructure in the state. I'm interested in a transportation bill that looks at long-term funding with new revenue that builds bridges and roads throughout the state of Minnesota. Just to conclude, I have the experience as an effective legislator. I have the experience working in the community for the last three decades as involved citizen, and I have the experience working in corrections 35 years in public safety and law enforcement. I'm an effective legislator at the Capitol. I look forward to continue working for you at that site. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Next, we'll hear from Tim Mahoney.
Gaps that has been that have been created because of the inequities in our system. I will also be focusing on jobs and completion of the Phelan corridor. When I first came to this legislature, we had just lost Whirlpool, three Hams Brewery, and 3M was downsizing, a total of 6,000 jobs. We've been able to bring back over 3,000 jobs through the Phelan corridor, and that's really where I've been a huge advocate for it. We have, and nowadays, we have to look everything through the eyes of of an equity lens. I will continue to look at that in the public safety, small businesses, how we deal with immigrants, earned safe sick time, and one of the special things in the last few years has been the restoration of felony rights. I think it's much smarter to spend $5,000 after someone has left prison and help them get on the straight and narrow rather than have them reoffend and go spend $50,000 to put them in a prison.
Thank you. Next, we'll hear from Andrew Livingston.
Hello. My name is Andrew Livingston. I'm running for House District 67A. I'd like to thank the League of Women Voters for putting this forum on. I'd also like to thank my most excellent competitor, Tim Mahoney, for running a campaign based on ideas. I've always found Mr. Mahoney to be a dedicated and hardworking public servant. And for my door-knocking time, I found that he has the respect and loyalty of his neighbors. It speaks highly of him. I'm not running against Tim Mahoney, the man. I'm running against the policies set by his party leadership, policies which I do not believe are in the best long-term interest of our district or our state. Policies include Minsure, which is, we're at over $400 million we've spent on this so far, and it has been a total failure. That's $400 million of our money, your money, down the drain. We can do better than that. I also oppose this obsession the legislature seems to have with light rail. The bureaucrats, especially from the county, are trying to push light rail through our district. I think that would be a big, big mistake. It even floated the idea of tearing up White Bear Avenue and putting light rail lines down there. That would be an absolute a nightmare. If our district has a main street, it's White Bear Avenue, and putting light rail or dedicated bus lanes on White Bear Avenue is a real mistake. These are just some of the policies which I do not believe are in the long-term interest of our district. My name is Andrew Livingston, running for House District 67A. Thank you.
Thank you. Joseph Wieberka.
Hi there. My name is Joseph Wieberka. I'd like to thank you for inviting me to this debate and thank everyone that came out to watch. I'm an average person with a small business. I've been in business for 5 years. I have 5 children. I'm a board member for an organization that brings awareness for U.S. veterans' suicides here in Minnesota. I see a problem with where our politics are going. Whether it's on the left or on the right, they're failing to come into the middle and agree. And I really believe that we need another option, another voice. I represent the Libertarian Party, and that's why I'm here today, is to give people more than 2 options. Part of what I would like to do is create incentives for job growth through reducing taxes and regulations on businesses, and also stop any irresponsible and overused spending that's happening in the government so that we can keep a little bit more money in our own pockets. Also, as well, I want to help by increasing our personal freedoms and liberties by making sure that parts of our lives are not being regulated that has no need to be regulated. Thank you.
Thank you. And our last candidate to speak is Fung Her.
Hello, everyone. I'd like to follow everybody's lead and thank you, the League of Women Voters and the Eastside Learning Hub Center that we are here, also District 1 Council and Mayor Community Service. Thank you for organizing this event, and thank you all for coming to join us. It's been a great honor to have served you for the last 4 years, and I think I've been quite effective as a first-term senator from Eastside St. Paul. You know, I may be among the little quieter member of the 67 center, but I speak up when it's necessary, and I spoke loudly, you know. So I've been advocating strongly for the Eastside St. Paul, and there has been progress, not just for our state, but also our district as well. You know, one thing that I want to point out is that East 7th Street is different from 4 years ago when I started to serve there. And, you know, we provide bonding dollar to build the Science and Educational Center for Metro State. And one by one, along the block, you know, all of those are tied into state funding and state application. I hold a bill with Representative Tim Mahoney to allow brownfield cleanup and demolition of all the old 3M site. So because of that bill, that's why you have McQueen's there and Luminous Security, all up to Eastside Library, and they're going to be more development in the East, here in the Eastside St. Paul. I want to tell you a little bit about my background. I'm a small business owner, and I'm a video photographer. I see two of my colleagues here shooting video, and Bernie holding the sound. But since serving the Senate, I did not have time to go back to my small business operation because I dedicate so much, you know, time to make Eastside better. So, you know, I'm committed to serve you again. I would be honored to get your vote for re-election. Thank you.
All right, thank you. At this time, we're going to open up to questions from the audience, and I want to encourage everybody to submit questions. You all have cards on your seat. We can get you more. As I'm waiting for our volunteers to bring questions to me, I haven't seen them as yet, I'm going to kick this off with a question on voting rights. We're here because we have a big election coming up, and currently under Minnesota law, when individuals are convicted of a felony, they do not have the right to vote until they've completely finished all correctional control, including parole and probation. I'd like each of the candidates to tell the audience, if they see this as problematic or concerning in any way, where they stand on restoring voting rights to individuals who are on parole or probation, and why. And before we get to answers, I just want to remind that we're going to continually rotate the order in which the candidates respond to questions. So for this first round, we're going to start with Fong He.
I'm in full.
Yes, thank you. They each candidate has 1 minute to respond to questions. Thank you.
I'm in full support of restoring people's right to vote if they have served a time. And as I go speaking to people, young people especially, I, you know, really emphasize on their right to vote in this country and make sure they stay as a good citizen and not losing their right to vote. I mentioned that when I talk to young people, or mentioned that when I talk to new citizen, and I mentioned that to new immigrant as well, that, you know, this country is, you know, is a free country, but you have to maintain to your right to vote. So I believe strongly if those who have served their time, we should work hard to restore them, give them a second chance. And a number of them work on my campaign too, and they work very hard on my campaign because since they can't vote right now, they want to make sure that other people can vote. So that's why they work very hard on my campaign.
Thank you. Andrew Livingston.
Well, current law states that they must complete the parole and probation before they end or probation before they can vote again. I would agree that that's the way the law should be. If you do the crime, you have to do the time, you have to do the punishments, and one of them is you lose your voting rights. That's just the way it is. I don't believe that we have onerous sentencing in this state, so that if you have to wait even a few years to vote again, that is just part of the punishment you have to accept for committing a crime.
Thank you. Joseph Wieberka.
Yeah, I absolutely believe that restoring voting rights should be essential. People make mistakes. It happens sometimes. You know, some people end up with a bad rap, and a lot of times it happens when they're young. They should have time. They should be able to redeem themselves. If they're good enough to have taxes collected from them, they should be good enough to be able to have a say in what happens in their government. Thank you.
Thank you. Sheldon Johnson.
I also strongly support granting voting privileges to felons who are still on paper, which is to say on probation or parole. I worked in that field for 35 years, and what I saw is individuals who have connection with the community are more likely to do well in the community if they have some engagement, some involvement, and being able to vote is just one of those things. So not only is it good for the individual, but it's also good for the community. So I strongly support granting those voting privileges.
Thank you. Lastly, Tim Mahoney.
Well, thank you again. And I was remiss to not thank the League of Women Voters before, so I want to make sure I do that. In today's Minnesota, we have approximately 20% of people on paper or in prison, and they cannot vote. And being on paper or on parole can be anywhere from a few years to 25 years, essentially not allowing someone to vote ever. I strongly support, and I will be carrying the bill to restore felons' votes this year. It'll go along with the Ban the Box bill that I carried 2 years ago and passed. I just believe that it is smarter to do as much as we can to get felons, released felons, back into society and not reoffend. It's so much cheaper, so fiscally smarter to do this, and it is the right thing to do.
Thank you. With that, we're going to move on to talk about transit. This is a question from the audience. Please talk about what you will do at the legislature to improve transit across the East Side, including but not limited to the Gateway Corridor BRT line. And we'll start with Andrew Livingston.
Well, as I said, I completely oppose this rush line, and I'll call it nonsense because that's what it is. The only rush is the bum's rush, and that's what the East Side gets. People who moved out of town, now they want to turn our district into a commuter lane so that they can get into work faster. Well, no, not if I have anything to do with it. I'm adamantly opposed to tearing up our streets and making our streets less safe by putting light rail on them or even dedicated bus lanes. We don't have enough street traffic lanes as it is. Putting a dedicated bus lanes or light rail is not going to help us at all. And I guess I'm pretty much out of time. Thank you.
Thank you. Tim Mahoney.
Well, thank you again. I strongly support transit in the city and transit ways, whether they are light rail, bus rapid transit, or dedicated lanes of some sort or another. We have one of the top districts for lack of car ownership. The people that live on the East Side need a way to get to the doctor, to the grocery store, to work. And secondly, if you take a look at where they have put light rail transit, and we haven't decided where it's going to go yet, so it's still a process, light rail transit over on the East Side, there has been dramatic improvement of the business climate and the housing stock.
Thank you. Sheldon Johnson.
I support all modes of transportation, and just to throw a bouquet out to District 1 and Paul Sawyer and that group, they've worked really hard to put in effect a bicycle transportation plan. That's the kind of thinking that we need, that's forward thinking. We need to look at all modes of transportation, whether it be car, whether it be transit, whether it be light rail. I'd really want to see that Gateway Corridor finished and be a part of our transportation system. Now, we need to work closely with other communities because that's the way the transportation plans. It's part of a whole regional infrastructure. But that's the kind of thing I enjoy doing, the kind of thing I am good at, is working with other communities. So that'll be what we'll try to do to get the transportation transit plans put in place.
Thank you. Fung Her.
I'm in support of mass transit, whether it's light rail or BRT or other sorts. Our population are growing. Minneapolis and St. Paul, we are growing in population. And, you know, having more car out there in the metro area will slow us down. And having mass transit will get people to work more efficiently. And so I'm in full support. As a matter of fact, even though St. Paul is considered as a big small town, you know, like we have a 7 small town big city, you know, 17 district council in one St. Paul, you know, and even when you have light rail coming through, mass transit coming through, we still can't keep that persona in many years to come. And so I think it's a forward thinking to have mass transit and also encourage the bike lane to be safe and respectful of pedestrians. So last summer I've been very active in engaging bike riding in throughout district.
Thank you. Joseph Weberka.
I oppose it. I think it interferes with small businesses and their development. I've seen it when they did all on university, you know, businesses weren't able to bring in the clientele. Our businesses play a vital role in our economy, and we need to be able to make sure we're not interfering with that. So I can't be in favor of that.
Okay, thank you. Our next question is about education. General question, how will you work to reduce the disparities in our education system? And we're going to go right back to Joseph Weberka.
I support the voucher system. I think that people should have more of a choice in where they put their children in education. I think that you should be able to go to a private school or a public school and have that choice and let the market kind of work its way out. I think it will also make it so more private schools will build more schools, especially in the St. Paul area, where I've seen schools be shut down left and right. So I think we need to make sure that we're opening up more options and encourage more private growth in the schools.
Thank you. Feng He.
I think a smaller size classroom will help, reduce disparity. Has been an issue for a long, long time. But we will, there's no silver bullet in solving this whole thing at one. But if everyone commit to working with the school, parents, teacher, community member working at the school, having summer youth programs, having after school programs, and at our rec center. I know that our rec center has been closing in the lower part of Eastside here. We need to restore that back and having more after school programs so that they can tutor our kids. And that will be one way to reduce our educational disparities. And funding will be also very important too. I'm glad that we were able to pay our school back. And the last 4 years was very progressive for us. We were able to pay our school back, and we also have all-day kindergarten. We also have food, free school lunch for those who qualify, providing their better learning when they have all this early learning and not being hungry at school.
Thank you. Tim Mahoney.
There are a number of ways that we could do this. I support multitudes of this. We just were able to fund all-day kindergarten for most children in the state of Minnesota. That's a good start. But one of the programs in the St. Paul schools is what they do is they keep their children for 2 hours after school. And they give them, if they're caught up on their homework, they get 2 hours of activities, whether it's the gym or art or band or whatever. If they are not, they have to do an hour's worth of homework. And then they get an hour's worth of activities. So there's always some reward there. We have to think outside of that box that we have been, we're caught in. Now that does cost money, but it also costs money for the parents in terms of child care, both in early morning and late afternoon. If we can keep these kids and help them with their homework, get better educated, they will do better tomorrow and they'll become more productive citizens, more productive taxpayers.
Andrew Livingston.
Well, making sure education is fully funded is, of course, the legislature's job. The Republicans in the House have increased spending for K through 12 education over $500 million this past session. That's part of the legislature's job. How that money is spent and the actual disparities that go on, that is actually the school district's job. If you go to my website, you'll find a link to the St. Paul School District. You go door to door, people ask you about things like this, disparities or what's going on in the schools. You know, the legislature does not run the school district. The school district board members do. And so I'd encourage you to ask that question, go down to the school districts and ask them, what are you going to do, Mr. School District Board Member, because that's not really the legislature's job.
Sheldon Johnson.
To deal with disparities, we really do need a multi-pronged approach. There's no one simple answer to this important issue that's not only an issue throughout the state, but especially important here in the city of St. Paul. We need to fully fund early childhood education as well as all-day K. Starting right from the early ages is probably as important as anything. We need to train teachers around the issues of disparities, and we need to particularly bring in teachers of color to be part of the whole instructional setup. And then lastly, I would say we need to be very intentional as policymakers as far as dealing with this issue. And that, for me, that would entail perhaps requiring each school district to come up with a very clear set plan on how they plan on dealing with disparities so the community can see what the plan is, what they can do, give some input, and move forward with it. So there's a variety of things we need to do, and we probably need to do all of them.
Thank you. Let's move on to talk about spending and what your spending priorities are. There's some concern that libraries, rec centers, community centers, small businesses are overloaded. What will you do to address these concerns, and whether you have any specific bonding initiatives planned for the East Side? And we'll start with Sheldon.
Okay, spending. I'm interested, like I said in my opening statement, in the bread and butter issues of how budget priorities should be spent. So that would entail public education, a good transportation system, public safety, law enforcement. These are some of the major issues that I would like to see addressed. And essentially what the state does is provide money to the school districts, to the county, and the city to make their internal decisions on how they want to spend that money. To that extent, we need to make sure that local government aid is directed to the city so they can ensure that our libraries and rec centers are well-funded. In terms of bonding issues, my top issue is the Third Street Bridge. That's anywhere from a $50 to $60 million project and needs to be replaced. And we need to get that done, and I'll be working hard for that this upcoming session.
Thank you. Joseph Wiverka.
My spending policy is basically cut the bacon and not feed the pig. The more you feed the pig, the greedier it gets, and that's exactly what's happening in our state legislature. We just ended up with $900 million surplus, and the first thing that came around said, how can we tax the people more? Can we tax their tabs? Can we tax the gas? The spending never gets to be enough. So unless we start finding the stuff that we can cut out and show that we do not need to tax more, and we just need to spend less. Thank you.
Thank you. Andrew Livingston.
Well, I'm in sympathy with my colleague here. In principle, I'm against bonding. We have to remember, bonding means borrowing money. And especially when we have a surplus, I don't understand why we have to keep going out and borrowing more money. I don't believe that's in the long-term interest of our state to wind up paying interest on a debt. They say that we're solvent, but, you know, I don't know that they've taken into account all these bonding measures that we've taken up over the years. And so in principle, I'm really against borrowing money to pay for projects that I think we could squeeze out of the budget if we try it harder now.
Thank you. Tim Mahoney.
Thank you. I want to correct something that my friend Mr. Livingston talked about, the $500 million in education funding. The Republicans, the GOP, proposed a cut to K-12 education. And in the state, in the city of St. Paul, we would have lost anywhere from 5 to 10% of our teachers. Most of them young people of color. Totally unacceptable if we're going to close the equity gap. And we have to thank the Senate and the governor for their holding out for that. My priorities in bonding will be the Humanities Center. One of the walls are falling down underneath, and that's a historic building that I think really does need and meets a lot of needs for the city and the state. My spending priorities for the next year will be how do we grow businesses on the East Side, particularly small businesses, particularly the businesses that are being led by people of color. Because if we create wealth in those communities, they will become part of the middle class, and they will do well on their own, making their own decisions without government interference.
Thank you. Feng He.
I'm for spending, and I'm for spending with responsibility. This is a capitalist society that we live in, and you know, it takes money to make money. We have to spend it wisely. I'm for securing money for local government aid, as well as economic development to resolve disparity in our community, and that in turn make money back. And some of the bonding priority for me will be the Eastside Freedom Library, Wangkun TP Center, and the Battle Creek Rec Center. They have been on the queue for a long, long time, and I think it should be time that they receive the dollars. And when we get the bonding for this, it's not just money squandered away, but it's money that create jobs. People who are going to develop, who are going to build, who are going to renovate the Eastside Freedom Library, are going to build the Interpreter Center at the Wangkun TP Center. It's creating jobs for them and offer us opportunity for green space and other varieties. So I'm for spending, but spending with responsibility. And Eastside has not asked much from the legislature in terms of money. So I'm going to reiterate that keep on asking us so that at least some will come through.
Thank you. Okay, let's shift gears again to racial disparities and racial equity. So what steps can we take as a state to start resolving economic disparities and racial disparities, and how can you bring together the white, black, Hmong, and Latino people of the East Side? Andrew Livingston.
Well, first, I believe it's not the state's purview to determine which group earns what, or I don't believe it's even within the state's competence to do that. I don't believe there is, it's quite frankly possible outside of a sort of draconian society we don't want to live in. It's really none of the state's business which particular group has more income than any other group. I think that's just the wrong way to go to try to do the bean counting and say, rob from Peter to pay Paul, or oops, you earned more this year, we're going to take it from you and hand it off to you. I don't believe it's in the state's competence to do that, and I don't believe it's in the state's purview to do that. And I don't believe that's what the founders wanted when they wrote our Constitution.
Thank you. Feng He.
Bringing people together is my motto, and the reason I chose to serve the Eastside St. Paul as your senator is trying to bring people together, people of different ethnic background, racial background, economic background. I have worked hard on that. To build the strength of the Eastside St. Paul. And I'm glad that my colleagues, whether the House member or Senate member, whether Senator Chuck Wigger in Maplewood or Senator Susan Kent, that they embrace what I'm volunteered to do in the small salary that I get. I'm working extra hard because our district is very, very diverse. You know, I have to put extra effort to bring people together. If the majority, the European descent of the populace know about certain issue or policy we pass, the Somali community has to know too. So as the Hmong community has to know, the Hispanic community has to know. And you know, I know that I work very hard on this. I'm self-sacrificed, but this is what I'm signed up for, and will continue to do that. You know, for the next 4 years.
Thank you, Sheldon Johnson.
Well, racial and economic justice is one of the top issues I think that we need to deal with at the Capitol. Some of the things that come to mind that I think we can do realistically is workforce training. I think we need to get into the communities of color and provide job opportunities and workforce training so they're good to go. In the employment field, I think we need to be active in searching out businesses that are owned by people of color and provide them with the capital necessary to get their feet on the ground and get those businesses going, because I think we know that those businesses that are owned by people of color are more likely to hire likewise as well, and I think that would be a good step. I'm proud to work with Senator Fong Heard. The work that he's talked about in terms of bringing community colors is real, and working together with him and Representative Mone to address these issues at the Capitol in a realistic and honest way, I think is a great step forward.
Great. Joseph Weberka.
Racism is real, it's alive, and it's something that's an issue with the hearts of people. It's not something that government can just regulate and make it go away. But it's a real problem here. But you can't just boost benefits for one group to bring them up. That's not equality. If you want equality, you have to have equal opportunity, and that has to go for everyone. When it comes to economic disparities, we need to make sure that we're providing opportunities for small businesses to grow in the communities that need it. I have a small business forgiveness plan where you can actually go into like a foreclosed property and or a vacant property that's been there for over 18 months and give it to them for tax-free for a year or two. So that way they can develop a business where they can hire people and make a bridge for that gap of economic disparities.
Thank you. Tim Mahoney.
Racial and economic inequality is something that we're going to have to keep in the forefront of our mind for public policy for the next 25 years, 30 years. But today, what we can do is we can do more with these communities of color to help them start their small businesses. We have a program at the state, and we have to work with the cities that do microloans, $25,000, $50,000. We have to connect them up with businesses, with banks, whether it is Bremer Bank, Sunrise Bank, Western Bank, to create that base for those particular economic people, economic growth. We can also look at how we do with the police department. One of the things at the state, and that's probably about the only thing we can do, is relook at post-board training for police officers. Post-training is what we do to train police officers. We can do a better job of training for de-escalation. We can do a better job of de-escalation and how we deal with our inherent biases. Now, St. Paul, I want everyone to understand that it is an example for the nation, but we can always do better, and so we've got a lot of pieces to work on.
Thank you. In some other states, the legalization of cannabis has resulted in tax revenue. Given that, two-part question really, do you support the legalization of cannabis in the state? And to what extent is increased tax revenue an important consideration when thinking about this issue? And we'll start with Sheldon Johnson.
The legalization of cannabis. Now, I've been a co-author of Industrial Hemp, which is different from cannabis if we're talking about smoking pot. I do think we can work with Industrial Hemp to move that forward, and I've been a co-author on that bill. With respect to marijuana, I was a co-author of the medicinal marijuana bill this last session, and that bill has passed, and it is currently being studied to see how effective it's going to be. So my feeling on making it legal throughout the state is I think we should step back and take a look to see how things are going in Washington and Oregon and so forth. I know California has a ballot initiative this year that's really going to change the game. I think we need to be cautious, see how it works, find out what the public health issues are and what the law enforcement issues are so that we can come together as a community, as a state, and make a decision that's in the best interest for all of us.
Thank you. Andrew Livingston.
Well, I'd agree with Mr. Johnson that industrial hemp is a legitimate business that should be authorized. Cannabis itself for recreational use, it's a dangerous narcotic, and I believe the will of the people right now is still that it should be against the law. I've been against marijuana since I was in high school when one of them ran me over one day, somebody on dope. Never had any use for it ever since. So I know my libertarian colleague will probably disagree with me, but I believe it's a dangerous narcotic, and the current laws are appropriate.
Thank you. Joseph Weverka.
He's right. I do disagree with him. I don't see it as any more dangerous than alcohol or tobacco. I mean, alcohol has caused so many deaths, and what has marijuana caused? How many deaths? I mean, maybe some people make poor judgment, but people make lots of poor judgment with alcohol as well. So you can't really say that it's a dangerous narcotic when we have legalized substances out there that's widely accepted. Legalizing cannabis is something that can help produce a lot of money and a lot of revenue for our state, as well as other aspects where it can free up jail space so we can actually put violent offenders in jail for longer times instead of jailing up nonviolent offenders. And it also can help reduce gang activity. That cuts off a lot of gang funding if you take away one of the black market items that they're out there selling on the streets. It makes our streets safer. And in reality, the government doesn't have a right over our bodies. And that's the most important part of it. I don't smoke marijuana, but I think that whoever does want to should have the full freedom to do so. Thank you.
Fung Her.
I have voted to support medicinal cannabis, and as far as recreational go, I think that there is need to be more research and more study at the federal level and then at the state level too. I myself, never touch marijuana, and being that I'm growing up a little clumsy myself, you know, I want to keep my mind clear. And so, you know, if you can keep your mind clear, be alert, that will be safety, but it's people's choice. But if we're going to legalize total recreation, I think more research needs to be done.
Tim Mahoney.
I'm actually on record as being in support of legalization of marijuana. And in terms of the dollar figures that it generates, the studies that I've seen or the states that I've looked at had these huge projections, and they always fall flat. So I don't think the tax dollars is that big of an issue. But every dime we make off legalized marijuana needs to go back into treatment programs. Not for schools, not for parks, not for anything else. It has to go back to help the addict. I could go a whole lot further on that particular piece. We do need to figure out a few pieces to it. You know, how do you charge and how do you determine and test if someone's driving under the influence of marijuana? We have some other pieces that have to be figured out. But we are seeing a flood of opiates into this state because marijuana, you can get it anywhere you want now. And it's not stopping, the police are not being able to stop it. So we have an opiate problem. We have to address that. And that should be and must be our biggest concern.
Thank you. So our country has seen a number of horrific incidents of gun violence in the recent past and throughout our history. So the question is, to what extent are guns a problem in District 67? And if you think they are, what do you propose doing about it? And do you think state gun laws need to be amended? Fung Her.
Well, that's a very, very tough question when you start narrow down to District 67 because it's an issue across the board and across our nation. I think we need to have a stricter gun law, you know, and more evaluation for mental health so that we don't put gun in hands of the wrong person or, you know, folks that, you know, are not mentally stable. So, you know, again, more research will need to be done here. I have grew up in a society where a gun is very easy accessible, and it become war. So, you know, I think that, you know, our country need to look at is a evil that, you know, fallen upon us. So, you know, stricter gun law will help reduce some of the issue that we hear about. But I hope that, you know, there won't be any national news that come out from District 67, and I pray on that. Thank you.
Joseph Weverka.
Guns aren't a problem. The people are. We have a Second Amendment right that allows us to carry arms. And it's just point blank period that it's our constitutional right. And as members of the House, as members of the Senate, we have a duty to uphold the Constitution of the United States, not twist it or pervert it or stretch it as thin as we can to make it something it's not. I don't want gun violence on the streets, but it's the criminals that are out there. I mean, creating more laws for legal gun holders isn't doing anything except suppressing the legal gun holders. We need to make sure that we're out there preventing the criminals from shutting down black market areas that are selling the guns on the streets. But to create more laws, it only hurts law-abiding citizens. It doesn't hurt nothing to do with criminals.
Tim Mahoney.
Excuse me. The gun laws of today, I'll be very simple here. I believe that we need to have universal background checks, and we need to close the gun show loophole, flat out. That's the first step that we need to do. As my libertarian colleague here said, we have a tremendous amount of laws in the books about gun crimes. And I do and strongly believe that if you commit a crime with a gun, you are not only crazy, but you are endangering too many people, even if it's just one person. And that is negotiated away, that particular part of the penalty is negotiated away in order to get a guilty plea on the other. That has to stop. If you committed a crime with a gun, you need to start realizing you're going to jail, you're going to prison, and you're gonna go for a while. But again, I own guns, I don't hunt much anymore. My wife wants me to get rid of them, but because I don't hunt any longer, they're locked in the closet with a trigger lock on it. I have many friends. I'm a retired pipe fitter. Everybody in my local has guns, more than one or two. I can't be against guns. They might find out where I live.
Thank you. Andrew Livingston.
Well, I'd agree with the good senator that I also pray that we never have any terrible incident here with firearms. However, I don't believe that firearms themselves are an evil. They're like any inanimate object. They're neither good nor bad. It's just what the people do with them. And so I agree with my libertarian colleague here that, you know, it's guns don't commit crimes, people do. I believe current laws are completely adequate. I don't see as we need to enact anymore. Again, the right to protect yourself or own, for whatever reason you choose, a firearm is a right of every person guaranteed by our Constitution, and I believe that very strongly.
Thank you. Sheldon Johnson.
The issue of guns is an interesting one because it doesn't really break around the Republican-Democrat ways. It's more of a metro versus rural issue, and we really need to deal with our rural colleagues in dealing with the issue. My feeling is that we can pursue reasonable gun safety legislation, and there is a middle ground that we can find. Universal background checks, I think, makes sense. Keeping guns out of the hands of convicted felons or someone who's committed domestic abuse seems pretty reasonable. If we know someone has a mental illness that's puts them in a situation where they're going to hurt themselves or others, I think it's reasonable to keep a gun out of their hands. Assault weapons, I'm not sure why we need that. So I think there are some policies and legislations that we can pursue that will make things safer. We need to work with our rural outstate folks to make that happen.
So the state of Minnesota is known for its water resources. We're the state of lakes, but we have a number of concerns regarding our water quality. The question is, what can you do to ensure that employment remains high in the Iron Range while protecting our valuable water resources up north? Joseph Weverka.
Well, I think to start, you have to reduce the government regulations. The government's one of the biggest polluters out there. So having them be in charge of making sure that in the Iron Range that there's less pollution is probably not the wisest thing to do. So if we cut down the regulations, then their costs are going to go down significantly, which therefore everything else will be cheaper. And then that's going to be able to provide more jobs in the industry. Thank you.
Thank you. Sheldon Johnson.
Well, this is a difficult issue that if it was easy, it would have been solved by now. I'm a strong believer in ensuring the water quality throughout the state, whether it's in northern Minnesota, southern Minnesota, and central Minnesota. So, but to me, that's the first priority. I think we need to look at what kind of job industry over the long term can we have on the Iron Range in northern Minnesota that's going to create the kind of long-term employment opportunities that don't require the sort of degradation to our water quality that might happen with some of these larger corporate multinational companies coming in and doing their work. So that would be my emphasis would be on finding different types of employment that didn't have to harm our water quality.
Thank you. Feng He.
Also for cleaner water quality, and I want to maintain the base of water quality, although job creation is you know, almost equally important, but I, you know, I'm in support of a legislator that will not just single out certain, you know, business that they have to follow a certain rule of sulfite regulation, and I think that, you know, slowly we allow room for that, for a company up north to open up and perceive. Perhaps next session we'll do that. But again, you know, we have to look at the long term. It's not just creating job quickly for the next couple of years. We have to look at long term, like who's making all the money? Is it the individual, the employees up there, or is it some multi-million dollar international operation that come into our state and take our wealth away? So that will be one part that I evaluate in contrast with the water quality.
Thank you. Tim Mahoney.
Well, this is actually a mining question, and should we mine up in the Iron Range? We're going to mine on the Iron Range. There's $7 to $12 billion worth of precious minerals underneath the ground up there. For me, it is a matter, and no international mining company has ever left an area unscarred, period. There is none. You cannot show me one. So the job that we have in front of us is how do we ensure that the mining companies that come to the Northland actually live up to their promises, don't declare bankruptcy, and leave us holding the bag. Because we've paid tons, millions and millions and millions of dollars to clean up the messes that these particular mining organizations have left. Here in the state of Minnesota, down in Utah, down in Brazil, that's unconscionable. And I refuse to vote for mining until I'm assured that they will their money will be there to clean that mess up, because there will be one. Now, we have to also figure out and force them to mine responsibly and not pollute if we can do that. That's a huge issue, a huge ask of us as legislators. We've got a audio person down there, we got a retired probation officer, an insurance agent, a small business owner, and a retired pipe fitter. We need a lot more science to understand this before we move forward.
I'm going to remind the candidates to be respectful of time limits. Andrew Livingston.
Yeah, I think we're pretty much all in agreement here. There is a tension there between the jobs and the water quality. And I would agree here that you don't want to just go after that quick buck. You have to think about the long-term ramifications of this and what's this going to cost us in the long term. I agree with Mr. Mahoney. Mining is going to go on up there. There's a lot of money up there to be made for the state and the people up there. But that does have to be balanced with water quality, of course. And I think this is something that we need to get with the DNR needs to work hand in hand with the legislature and any business that wants to run up there to make sure that we can all get around a table and nod, okay, this is going to make everybody happy. That is something that really has to be done.
Thank you. So moving on, thinking about college costs have been rising. and are out of reach for a lot of individuals. Do you support free community college for graduates of Minnesota high schools? And do you think that this is a feasible option? And what might you do to pursue this? We'll start with Fung Her.
I do support free community college, but have to have certain kind of criteria. It just cannot be free for everyone. You're going to have crowd congested application. What's the criteria to go there? But I'm glad that within the last 4 years we were able to hold tuition freeze, and we'll continue to work on tuition freeze for the next couple of years on this next term, so that we can make, we can reduce student debt. That's more important right now, to hold on to tuition freeze and figure out the requirement for free community college. That's very likely for me.
Thank you. Andrew Livingston.
I would not support making community colleges free. I know people, I especially know young people, you send someone to school for free, it doesn't, what you achieve too cheaply, you value too lightly. People need some skin in the game, to use the expression. If they want to go to college, they have to put some money into it, and then they'll get something out of it. I really don't think that's the road to go down, is trying to give things out free, because free is a misnomer. Somebody's gonna pay, all right, and it's everybody in this room is gonna pay. So I would not agree with going down to the road of trying to make free community college. No.
Joseph Weberka.
I agree with you. College shouldn't be free. It's a private entity for one, so government shouldn't be funding it. The other part about it is, if you want college costs to really go down, you need to quit telling all your kids just go to college, go to college. We've said it, every single person to college. What about trade school? And college isn't really meant for every single person out there. There's trades out there as well. And if every single person wasn't so pressured to just get into college, the cost would go down, because the supply and demand would be lower. But they have to raise the cost to make so people can get in those seats. Basically, you have to encourage other routes of education afterwards. Thank you.
Thank you. Sheldon Johnson.
Well, I think a free community college or technical school, let's say St. Paul College, for example, is an admirable goal, and I'd definitely be interested in having that out there as something to seek. The problem is, of course, the cost, realistically, what that would entail. We'd have to look at what that would cost. We did a freeze in 2014 on tuition for our state colleges and university system. That cost $250 million, $250 million to keep that in effect. So we also need to be realistic, but whoever asks the question has the right idea, which is education is such an important key for people to move forward. So to the extent that we can do that, either working with our high schools so we can get some of those issues of education taken care of right on the last junior, senior year, whether we can move forward with community college that's at more affordable and technical school that's more affordable, I'm totally in favor of that, because as my friend Joanna Clark knows out here, we really want to get our kids educated and off to a good start.
And Tim Mahoney.
Thank you. My plan is to get Hillary Clinton elected, and she can tax the transaction tax on Wall Street, and they'll pay for most of our college. At least that's the start. That plan doesn't particularly work. How about the state? Back in 1995, the state paid 2/3 of the cost of college. Today, it pays 1/3. So we flipped that. The students are now paying 60% of the cost of a college. That's unacceptable if we want to continue to be, as one of my heroes, Rudy Perpich, said, the brain power state. We need to lower that. Free college, it's a nice ideal, but it's not going to happen. But we, the state, need to pick up more of the cost of college. And our colleges are huge economic engines. The state of Minnesota is probably one of the stars of the upper Midwest, because we have a very, very well educated, about 37% of our population has college or some kind of college. Now, I will agree with my libertarian friend, there are many more options than just college.
Thank you. So names and symbols are important. I think we would all agree. Do you support Minnesota renaming Columbus Day to Indigenous Americans Day? And is there anything you would do to make the state seal more representative of Minnesota today? Andrew Livingston.
Short answer is no. No. That's quite frankly, it's a... No, the purpose of Columbus Day is to honor the act of exploration, of setting out boldly where into the unknown, and we celebrate the man who did it. If people came after and did bad things, or if even if he did bad things later, that's not what we're celebrating. You have to understand the spirit behind this. Columbus was a great man who did a wonderful thing. He went out where people told him, you can't do that, and he went out and did it anyway. And I think that's the kind of thing we need to celebrate. The state seal, it has pretty much everything on there. I mean, it's got sunrise, it's got a farmer, it's got a Native American. I mean, I don't know what else you could do. I think it's a fine seal. It's a great state. It's a great state seal, and we just have to leave it the way it is.
Thank you. Tim Mahoney.
Yeah, I'm not a big fan of changing the state seal a second time. They had to change it once when the Native American person was heading east rather than west, so I think it's just fine. Indigenous Persons Day, I think it's... I would prefer to set up another holiday. I think we, as Americans, all work too hard anyhow. So I think we should take another day off, and I'd do it in Indigenous Peoples Day.
Sheldon Johnson.
I would be supportive of changing from Columbus to Indigenous Peoples Day. It certainly wouldn't be a top priority. I think even more important is to put in place the policies and the funding and the legislation that supports our Indigenous people, our Native Americans. I think that's even more important. So I wouldn't get hung up on the name change at this point. I think doing the work at the Capitol on the issues that are more important to their actual lives would be essential. You know, we've been working at the Capitol on these paintings that are from the last century, and some of those paintings haven't been as attractive to the Native people. I think that's an example where we can actually make some changes today to upgrade some of the images that people see on a daily basis when they come to the Capitol. So that might be a compromise sort of activity to do to provide the sort of attention to this issue that it deserves.
Fung Her.
As far as changing our state seal, I'm open for the idea to hear what the next version is. I know that the early one was a little bit more hostile until the one that we have now. And I do like the one we have now, but I like to see that whatever model, I'm open to hear more. You know, I like the part where they said Le Tour du Nord, and there's a French word. And, you know, I was invited to celebrate the Hmong 40th year of exile in France, and they were so proud. The Hmong community was so welcoming to me because I carry a flag said Le Tour du Nord, you know, North Star State. And I'm you know, whatever modification it is, I still like to have the French word Le Tour du Nord there. As far as the Indigenous Day, I do respect a lot of explorers in the world, and it's a good education for all of us. But I like to say empower the Indigenous, because story cannot be told from one direction, not the direction of conquer. The story has to be told by the Indigenous people, how they want to name date that they want to name. So I'm in support of that.
Thank you. Joseph Weverka.
I can't believe this would be an issue that we'd spend tax dollars on arguing about on the House floor. It seems like a very big waste of money to get all the members of the House and the Senate and the governor involved and say, hey, let's argue out what our state flag should be changed to when it's a perfectly fine flag. I agree with you, though, that, I mean, we could just have another Indigenous Day and just have a whole separate thing. But at some point, you have to have...
Friday before Columbus Day. We'd have
there you go.
Weekend.
There you go. Exactly. I work out perfect, and a lot of people would be happy about that. But it's something... There's a lot more issues out there than that, and I just think there's more serious things to worry about.
Thank you. We have time for one more question tonight. And this question is on election standards. So we now have ranked choice voting in both Minneapolis and St. Paul for city elections. With growing interest in alternative parties and independent candidates, where do you stand on expanding ranked choice voting to state elections? And we'll start again with Joseph.
I support it. Fully.
Great. Fung Her.
For state level, I don't support it. I don't support ranked choice voting. I support for local level. It's confused enough, you know, being, you know, back to my getting people together idea, you know. Folks of new American citizens are still having trouble getting to vote. And we even restrict people helping other people to vote up only to three. You know, when you're trying to get new American out to vote, but you only let someone helping them only to three people, there are a disparity here already. So, you know, let's figure that part first, and let's figure the local, make it local clear first. Educate people on vote, ranked choice voting first. I went to help Minneapolis at one time when there were 36, you know, candidate there. The new citizen don't have a clue who to vote for. They only mark whatever's first, and then good thing is a random vote. You know, they only mark the first one. So, you know, I don't know how it's gonna be national or gonna be state ranked choice is gonna add more confuse to the people that I represent. You know, so that's where I stand.
Tim Mahoney.
Senator Herr actually hit it on the head. It's a confusing system for too many people at the present time. And the studies are starting to show, or at least the ones that I've read, that people go in and they vote for the best state legislator ever, Tim Mahoney, and then they wouldn't be adding in the next two or three. Small percentage do that ranked choice voting. I think it's fine for municipal elections at the present time. We do have a ways to go. And just to finish up, to go back to the last question, I was literally serious. I think Columbus Day is an important discovery issue, but the citizens, the indigenous people need their day. They had this land pushed out from underneath them. And I think they should have a day to celebrate their heritage. It's really important. So I didn't want to sound like I was making light of it. And a four-day weekend is a good idea. We work too hard in this state, in this country.
Thank you. Sheldon Johnson.
Ranked choice voting, I supported it at the local level, and I think it's working reasonably well. At the state level, I'd probably be a little bit more hesitant. I'd be open-minded to it. I'd be willing to look at the research and the pros and cons and make a reasonable judgment based on that. I have some of the same concerns that Senator Herr has raised in terms of its being confusing, particularly to first-time voters. I'm more interested in ensuring that we get everyone out to vote and they feel comfortable with the experience and they continue voting on a regular basis. To me, that's a larger priority than RCV, but again, I wouldn't have a mind set on it, be willing to look at the pros and cons.
Andrew Livingston.
Yeah, I'd also agree that getting people out to vote at all is a bigger priority. You know, knock on doors and you walk into people who they don't vote, you know, get out of here, you GDF and politician. I think just getting out people to vote is more important. It's my understanding ranked choice voting, you might wind up with runoffs, and just trying to get people to the polls once is hard enough. So I would say no on that.
Thank you. At this time, we're done with the question and answer period, but what we always do is read the questions that we did not have time for the candidates to answer. It's important that the candidates know the concerns of the audience and what people are thinking. So I will now go through the questions that we don't have time tonight to respond to. I particularly like this one. Should Minnesota offer the position of State Poet Laureate to Bob Dylan? Major sports events often coincide with higher rates of human trafficking, excuse me. How do you envision addressing this at this time? What will you do in the legislature to help rehabilitate drug offenders and help them become productive adults? What are your ideas regarding funding of healthcare? Recently, local press reported that the U of M used over $500,000 in public and tuition dollars to fight a union organizing drive among its faculty. What concrete steps will you take to ensure the U never again uses public and tuition funding for union busting? The state of Colorado recently implemented a program which provided low to no cost access to long-acting reversible contraceptives, such as IUDs. This program led to significant reductions in teen pregnancies and abortions in the state. Would you support a similar program in the state of Minnesota? Do you support inexpensive fiber to the home internet service to every St. Paul household, to every Minnesota household? Collapsing river bluffs have killed St. Paul children. Would you support statewide legislation restricting development on the bluffs? And finally, how do you feel about term limits? So with that, we're going to move to closing statements, and we'll go in reverse order, as we did with opening statements. So we'll start with Fung Her.
Okay, just going to do...
2 minutes. Yes, 2 minutes.
Well, I want to say so much. I'm going to do this on the fly. I have a little note. I want to say so much. I thank all of you for being here. It's been a great honor serving with you for the last 4 years, and it was a good experience for me. I learned a lot. I learned a lot, and you know, I learned how to be more effective. And this second term will be different. This second term, I'm no longer a freshman, even though maybe I may be the first freshman class, but I'm second degree now. You know, so you know, I will work hard for you. You know, I will work on statewide issue as well as Eastside issue, and even to a level issue, like I passed a Jake Brake bill just so that truck on 94 would not hurt just certain individual ears that live along there. So I'm open for you all. I encourage all of you just to make a lot of noise, whether it's safe pedestrian crossing or more money to bike lane or economic development. NERD blocks program, anything. The more you ask, I'll put into bill, the more we throw out there, the more chance we get resources to Eastside St. Paul, because I know that our district are among the low economy district, and there are other districts that have organizers, tons and tons of organizers. They will bring so many bills each session, and it's harder for us, but I'm encouraging all of you guys just to pepper us with bills, and we'll filter out the one that's more legitimate, more sound, and introduce those. So thank you all for coming, and don't forget to vote. Don't forget to vote and get other people to vote. I want to maximize our voter district here so that we are ahead of the other 66 districts. So thank you.
Thank you. Joseph Weverka.
I want to thank everybody who came out here. I'm sure most of you know, I'm brand new to politics. This is my very first debate, and I really appreciate the crowd here, and I appreciate the company that I have up here as well. I hear a lot up here of kind of the same thing over and over. Let's grow the government, let's expand the government, let's make regulations, let's make rules. And I'm the candidate up here that I believe is the one who wants to reduce the taxes, reduce the regulations. One of the questions that was asked before about the marijuana laws, I believe that we can do a lot right there. We can, Sheldon said, with the hemp industry. The hemp industry, we can make 30,000 different products with, and that's a lot of jobs that can come through. We can expand medicinally. I know people that treat themselves with PTSD with marijuana, and that's a big deal, because if it's helping, let's get it out there so that people can treat themselves. It creates open competition with the pharmaceutical company so that we can actually bring down prices in medicine as well. We need new ideas, and right now it's the same old, same old. So I'd like to bring new ideas to East St. Paul. Another priority is to clear up these vacant lots. We have vacant lots all over the place. They're just invitations for crime. We need to do something about that and be proactive towards that. When I was out canvassing, it was one of the most priorities for concern that I heard out there. So, like I said, it was good talking with you guys. I hope you all go out and vote, which I'm sure every one of you will vote. And keep in mind that you have more than two options this year. Thank you.
Andrew Livingston.
You know, I last session, I ran for, I had three basic things I wanted. I wanted a flat tax, I wanted exempt seniors from property tax, and I wanted a primary. Well, it looks like the legislature went and passed the primary, so it's one down and two to go. I agree with my colleague here, Mr. Johnson, that people who earn more should pay more, and I think the best way to do that is with a flat tax with no exemptions, which would include capital gains. I have more on that on my website, livingstonformnhouse.com. And again, property tax, I think the seniors have paid enough, and they should be exempted from paying property taxes. Again, my name is Andrew Livingston. I'm running for House District 67A. Please, everyone, I couldn't agree with everyone else more, get out and vote. Thank you.
Thank you. Tim Mahoney.
Well, thank you, everyone here, and I'd like to thank the moderator, Sarah. Thank you so very much. I hope you'll vote for me, Tim Mahoney, is District 67A. I have the qualifications. I've spent 18 years there. I'm in the past chair of the Jobs Committee. I have sat on the Bonding Committee, the Transportation Committee, the Commerce Committee, and unfortunately the Civil Law Committee. I have learned how to get people together, set goals. And one of the things as a retired pipe fitter that I do and I do well is once is a goal set, there's got to be a blueprint for that goal. And I will follow that blueprint to get that goal accomplished at the state capitol. Whether it's jobs along the Phelan Corridor, that was almost a path when I first went in there, and now it's almost fully developed. It's got some ways to go, but it is getting closer and closer. One of the goals that we have many challenges on the east side, but I'm going to go back to the equity piece because it is really a key to developing the middle class again on the east side. How do we bring people of color into the mainstream economy? That's going to be really, really important because the more money you put in their pocket, the less questions or needs they have from government. One of the other things I'll be working on is workforce development. I've spent my whole career there doing that. We are facing a 20% workforce shortage in the next 15 to 20 years. Again, 20%. We need to have the best educated kids coming out of our K-12 system. We have to have multiple options once they get out of college, whether it's a certification or a two-year degree or a four-year degree, because we need to continue to be the brain power state. What this world is bringing to us in the next 20 years, from robots to driverless cars to amazing medical discoveries, are going to change the way we work and who has to work and how they work. So I will continue to do that kind of work at the Capitol. Thank you.
Thank you. Sheldon Johnson.
Well, I think this was much better than the Trump-Clinton debate. And
nasty woman.
Though I don't agree with Mr. Werberker or Mr. Livingston on their policy approaches, I think they're very articulate, and I appreciate them coming here and sharing their ideas. I think they're worth listening to and thinking about. The reason I'm running is, as I said, to invest in kids and communities in the state, particularly east side of St. Paul. I think that's what I want to see happen. I want to focus on the bread and butter pocketbook issues, issues like freezing tuition, affordable child care, paid earned sick leave so people can stay home and take care of their kids or the aging parents or themselves. As Tim mentioned so well, racial and economic justice issues are huge for the east side of St. Paul. We need to have a community where everyone feels like they're engaged, involved, and have a piece of the pie. And we need to do things in terms of our educational setup, in terms of workforce development, in terms of job opportunities, so everyone can and feel they're a part of things. We need to pass a bonding bill. We need to get that Third Street Bridge replaced. We need to have a good transportation plan. That's that's long-term, that brings new revenue in to pay for things. These are just some of the things we need to do over the next couple of years. My background, again, is in corrections, where I served for 35 years. I've been active in the community. I've been an effective legislator at the Capitol for the last few years. I appreciate your support, and I really appreciate you coming out and sharing your time with us tonight. Thank you.
Thank you. And this concludes our candidate forum tonight, and I'd like to thank our candidates for taking the time to be here with us tonight and everybody who showed up in the audience. I'd also like to thank our timekeepers and other volunteers who made this happen. I think we all know voting day is November 8th. We have lots of options in Minnesota. You can get out and vote early. I presume most of you know that. You can walk in or you can vote by mail. And all of that information is on the Secretary of State's website, www.sos.state.mn.us. So thank you again. This concludes our forum for tonight. Yeah, thank you.